You're with Proactive at the ASX Small and Mid-Cap Conference 2020. And joining us from Anatara Lifesciences is Steve Lydeamore. Steve, good to meet you. How are you?
Good, thank you.
Good to hear, Steve. Look, give us a quick introduction, if you would, to Anatara.
Anatara is focused on gastrointestinal disease, or gut health, if you like, for both animals and for humans. We're presently advancing a clinical trial, which we plan to start in the end of this calendar year for irritable bowel syndrome. So that's a big part of what we're about.
So give us a bit more detail in as far as how the planning for that trial is taking shape.
Look, it's been quite a journey to get here. We've designed a product from scratch, designed to treat the underlying issues with patients for IBS. Successfully been through preclinical development, both in the lab and in mice. We're now heading with confidence into the clinic. There was a bit of a delay in getting this set up because COVID made it difficult to start trials, but we've designed a virtual trial and we've got most of the CRO contracts in place and getting ready to submit to the ethics committee.
So how might that virtual trial take place?
Yeah, so the difference between a normal trial is that patients typically go in to an institution like a hospital or a clinic or something to get their medicines and do all of those things. In this instance, we'll be recruiting patients, mostly via social media. They will need to go and see their local physician to check for eligibility for the trial. And after that, almost everything else, apart from doing a bit of blood work at the end, will be done from the patient's home. So there's an app that's been developed, so they'll record their, the medicines that they take and all of the various patient-reported outcomes. They'll do their stool samples, which is part of the trial, and so all of this stuff they can do from the comfort of their home. There's some benefit because people outside of cities, which may not normally participate in trials, should have the option for participating.
How long would you expect this trial to take?
The trial itself, as with any trial, depends on how long it takes to recruit patients. So there's a lead-in period of a couple of weeks. The patients are on treatment and there's a follow-up period. But depending on how long it takes for recruiting determines the trial. But, approximately 12 months in total.
And alongside the planning that you're doing here, are you also undertaking some partnering discussions?
We are, and that's important. The strength of the preclinical data, as I described before, we got statistically significant results showing that it does what we were seeking to do, that is to address those underlying causes of what we believe of these symptoms. So microbiome dysbiosis, inflammation of the gut, and gut lining barrier defects. So if we can do that, there should be an interest from global consumer health companies, and we're finding that that is the case. So we've started those discussions already.
Realistically, how soon might a deal be in place, do you reckon?
Look, it could be as soon as the end of this calendar year. We need to make some decisions depending on how those discussions are going, whether we strike that deal at the end of the year or soon thereafter. There could be some optionality associated with the trial. They could want to participate in the trial, but there's genuine interest there. So there's a distinct possibility we could have a deal before the end of this calendar year.
Might be a fairly obvious question, but irritable bowel syndrome, how much of a problem is it?
Look, it's the most diagnosed condition by gastroenterologists. So it's approximately 11% of the global population. In Australia, it's more like 15%. One in five people during their lifetime are likely to experience it. So it's quite prevalent. And if you don't know anybody that has it, it's probably because they don't want to talk about having diarrhea or constipation or those types of things.
Are there no current treatments?
Look, in Australia, there's one prescription medicine that's approved for it, and that's focusing on the abdominal pain and cramping aspects. Other than that, people generally use complementary and alternative medicine. So there are some products on the market. So in Australia, probably Iberogast is the most used for it. Buscopan is also used for treating cramping. But, we don't think, based on surveys that we've done, that symptoms are adequately controlled for the lifetime of the patient. There is no cure, so there's a high unmet need.
And Steve, what are you doing in the area of animal health?
Animal health was where the company started out. So we have developed successfully a product for treating scour, which is diarrhoea in piglets. It's approved in Australia by the APVMA. We're seeking to expand utility of that product into larger pigs through an in-feed product, and also into other species, so poultry, for example. You know, a lot more chicks out there than there are piglets. So a big market opportunity. We've got a formulation ready and have signed up University of New England's poultry hub to do a trial. It's going to commence soon with the results due in the end of January.
But is it fair to say that human health is your priority?
Human health is our primary focus that we're spending most of our time on, but we don't want to underplay the value of animal health. You probably heard about tanning microbial resistance and issues in livestock animals. So our product's a non-antibiotic solution, and we think there's a place for that product, and trying to find a good home for it.
Steve, it's been really good to meet you. Thanks for your time.
No, thank you.